Good morning, I'm Mike DeValio.
And I'm Nikki De Guzman.
Join us as we give you the rundown of the news you need to know today. In the headlines, parts of Cagayan and Isabela now under signal number 3 as Florita intensifies into a severe tropical storm.
A women's group set to file administrative charges against police officers who violently disrupted their distribution of school supplies to students in Quezon City on Monday. We speak with Gabriela Secretary General Felice Ponce later on the program.
A fourth monkeypox case detected in the Philippines.
And the face of America's pandemic response, Dr. Anthony Fauci, set to resign from his government post.
Thank you for joining us. Florita intensifies into a severe tropical storm as it moved towards the Isabela, Cagayan area. It was last spotted 120 kilometers east-northeast of Casiguran, Aurora, backing maximum sustained winds of 95 kilometers per hour with gusts of up to 115 kilometers per hour. Signal number 3 has been raised in parts of Cagayan and Isabela. Meanwhile, over a dozen areas, including Abra, Ifugao, Ilocos Sur and Ilocos Norte are under signal number 2. Signal number 1 is up in Bulacan, Laguna and Pampanga and other provinces in Luzon.
Severe tropical storm Florita is expected to make landfall over the east coast of Cagayan or northern Isabela this morning or early afternoon. But already, several parts of Cagayan province have been flooded. Haris Julio joins us now for updates on evacuation efforts. Haris, how are things there?
Severe tropical storm Florita has not yet made landfall, but some areas in Cagayan have already experienced flooding due to heavy rains. According to the Provincial Disaster Risk Reduction and Management Office, flooding occurred in the towns of Bagao, Gonzaga, and Gataran. Last night, some residents in Barangay Taytay, Bantay, Bagao were forcibly evacuated. According to the Municipal Disaster Risk Reduction and Management Office, they first implemented a preemptive evacuation in the afternoon due to threat of a landslide. In total, 36 families, which comprise of 103 individuals from Zone 6 and Zone 7, were brought to the barangay's multi-purpose hall. Seven families comprising of 18 individuals in Barangay Bagunot were also evacuated due to flooding, while four families or 15 individuals in Barangay Bitag Grande also evacuated and are temporarily staying with their relatives. Meanwhile, the Sipaga Bridge in Barangay Nangalinan was impassable after its approach was damaged by floodwater. Due to heavy rains, the river overflowed in Barangay Carupian, Bagao. The floodwater submerged some cornfields. In Gonzaga Town, residents in Barangay Kasitan experienced knee-deep flooding yesterday. About 49 families or 190 individuals were brought to the evacuation center. Three families, including 30 individuals in Barangay Pateng, were also evacuated due to flooding. The road in Barangay Piña Oeste, Gataran was also flooded, making it difficult for residents and motorists to cross. In Apari, 197 passengers, mostly students, were stranded at Dapa Wharf yesterday. They were supposed to go home after their class was suspended, but the Philippine Coast Guard did not allow the boats to travel on the river due to bad weather. The Coast Guard assisted the stranded in going home using their vehicles. The Coast Guard warns fishermen not to venture out on the sea. No sail policy as well as liquor ban are also in effect in the province of Isabela to ensure the safety of residents. Just a while ago, heavy downpour was experienced here in Ilagan City, Isabela. It lasted for a few minutes. We are now experiencing a downcast skies with a bit of gustiness. According to the Provincial Disaster Risk Reduction and Management Office, the main roads are still passable. Electricity and communication line are also good. Meanwhile, Magat Dam continues to release water. As of 11 o'clock last night, 545 cubic meters per second or equivalent to 2,725 drums of water were being released. The water elevation is at 186.79 meters above sea level, short of 3 meters before it reached the spilling level of 190 meters. Residents are still being advised to be extra careful because of the possible impact of the water being released by Magat Dam. That's the details here. Back to you.
All right, thanks for that update. Harry is to you.
Florita also causes flooding in parts of Ilocos Norte. Reynel Pawid is there and he joins us live for an update. Reynel, how's the situation looking like?
Yes, good morning, Mike. Mike, shockingly, the sun starts to shine here in Batac, Ilocos Norte. But yesterday, several houses were flooded due to the heavy rains brought by Typhoon Florita. Signal number 2 has been raised all over the entire Ilocos region. Mike, the Kiawit River here in Barangay Valdez started overflowing around 5 in the afternoon this Monday. The rain stopped overnight, causing the water to the river to subside. This left mud on the road and some houses in Barangay Lakub and Barangay Nalukta. Meanwhile, classes have been suspended at all levels, whether in public or private schools, throughout Ilocos Norte and Ilocos Sur. According to the Provincial Disaster Risk Reduction and Management Office, 68 houses have been submerged in the flood in municipality of Pinili. While in town of Adams, all telecommunication lines are experiencing signal failure due to the intensity of the rain. On the other hand, Mike, a gale warning is in the effect for the eastern coast of northern and central Luzon, including the northern coast of Ilocos Norte. Fishermen and small watercraft users are advised not to venture out. Mike?
Reynel, are we expecting any more rains? What are local authorities saying there? Are they letting their guard down or still preparing for that typhoon?
Yes, Mike, they're still on red alert because they're expecting the typhoon to landfall around this morning. So during the overnight, they were already in alert here, and all equipment are all set up and clearing operations are underway. Mike?
All right. Thank you so much for that update and keep safe. Reynel Pawid.
Several other areas have declared class suspensions today due to Typhoon Florita. These include schools in Baguio, Benguet, and La Union. Some government offices in affected areas will also be closed due to bad weather.
Meanwhile, other schools pushed through with the first day of classes on Monday, despite the rains and flooding. Gracie Rotao has this report.
In low-lying areas of Makabebe, Pampanga, the students struggle through one-foot-deep waters in the barangays of Saplad David, Kadwangtete, and San Gabriel just to get to school. San Vicente San Francisco National High School remains flooded from recent rains, and the flooded areas include a covered court and some classrooms. They had to walk on sandbags or chairs to avoid getting wet, but school officials remain undaunted.
Gagawa kami ng mga pathway para interlink, no? Naka-interlink lahat mga kwarto. But again, may mga challenges pa yung sa arapat na yun. Napakalaking chance kasi may dadaan na sasakyan. Kaya sandbagging.
Flooding is not new to schools in Masantol Town. Authorities say about 22 elementary and high school are affected by flooding. Aside from flood safety, Pampanga Vice Governor Lilia Pineda reminds students to observe minimum health standards to prevent the spread of COVID-19.
Dapat mag-ano rin sila nung distancing at saka yung observation nila. Ano kaya ang magiging anong ingat nang gagawin nila? Hindi yung parang, sa tingin ko kanina, parang wala eh. Parang wala na silang iniintinding Omicron, parang wala na silang iniintinding COVID. Parang back to normal. Dapat naman, hindi ganun.
In San Miguel Town in the province of Bulacan, some classrooms are also underwater. In Doña Damiana de Leon Macam Memorial Elementary School, a stage has been turned into a classroom.
Magkakaroon ng simultaneous dredging sa main rivers ang ating dalawigan. Mapapansin mo talaga dati, yung mga kalsadang pinagpatong-patong na namin.
Rains brought by Tropical Storm Florita triggered floods in Cagayan Province. Flood waters reached many schools, including the school in the town of Alacapan and the Libertad National High School in Abulug Town. School officials eventually decided to send the students home. Other schools in the province suspended classes. One kindergarten in Lawag City also stopped classes after storm signal number 1 was hoisted over Ilocos Norte Province. Classes were suspended in Legazpi City, Albay due to torrential rains. Class suspension in all levels was also implemented in Ginobatan, Albay due to potential floods. Parents, students, and teachers were stranded in Pasig City, Iloilo due to damaged bridge. They had to board a raft to cross the river. The bridge was damaged during Typhoon Agaton. Gracie Rutau, ABS-CBN News.
Aside from the flooding and school suspensions in some areas, the Education Department says there were no other reports of major problems during the first day of face-to-face classes in the country. Vice President and Education Secretary Sara Duterte led the opening of the school year in an elementary school in Bataan. There, she hailed the return of in-person classes as a victory for basic education after 2 years of distance learning due to the pandemic.
Isang malaking tagumpay para sa mga kabataang Pilipino ang muling pagsisimula ng in-person learning ngayong araw na ito. Isang hakbang na buong tapang na ginawa ng Department of Education sa kabila ng mga hamon at takot na dala ng COVID-19 pandemic. Hindi po natin binabalewala ang mga pangamba na dulot ng pandemya. Dahil diyan, naglatag po tayo ng mga alintuntunin para maiwasan na mahawa ng COVID-19 ang ating mga learners at mga teaching and non-teaching personnel sa paaralan. At katuwang po natin ang Department of Health dito.
Duterte, meanwhile, assured the education sector their concerns are being heard. But she asserts it's about time for the Filipino youth to return to schools.
Narinig din po natin ang mga panawagan ng ilang mga organisasyon na suspindihin muna ang pagbubukas ng klase at gawin na lang ito sa September o October. May mga naipahiyag na punto, na wasto at may dahilan. Pero ang pinag-uusapan po natin dito ay ang kinakabukasan ng kabataang Pilipino. We can no longer make a COVID-19 pandemic as an excuse to keep our children from their schools. The Philippines has been reopening up just like the rest of the world has reopened. We cannot make the lack of educational infrastructure or the inadequate number of classrooms in certain provinces another excuse to keep our children from schools.
The Education Department says some 28 million students have enrolled for school year 2022 to 2023.
President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. welcomed the return of face-to-face classes in most schools. He says he has always believed learning will be more effective inside classrooms where students and teachers can fully interact. Marcos adds he has no doubt students will get the quality education they deserve, with Vice President Sara Duterte leading the Education Department. He also reminds teachers and students to continue observing health protocols as the threat of the pandemic lingers.
Senator Grace Boehm, meanwhile, says the country could have been better prepared for the reopening of classes. She says all concerns hounding the sector, like public transport system, should have been addressed first. For ACT Teachers Party List Representative Franz Castro, the Education Department should have imposed guidelines on class size before schools reopened in-person learning. She says she was able to visit a school in Quezon City and found students were cramped inside classrooms.
The Social Welfare Department taps local governments to help ensure a more orderly distribution of educational cash aid. Thousands had flocked to the agency's offices across the country last weekend, hoping to receive the cash assistance for indigent students. But huge crowds and lack of clear guidelines led to chaotic situations that left several people injured.
Gusto po namin ilapit na itong educational system sa mga bata sa bawat bayan, bawat lungsod ng ating bansa para hindi na po sila maglandarapa, magpapila, magtulakan sa mga tanggapan ng DSWD. Ang mga GLGU ang magsasabi kung saan ang payout sa kanilang mga bayan, sa kanilang mga lugar.
Local governments had previously faced criticism that aid was not fairly distributed to their constituents during pandemic lockdowns. The president of the League of Cities calls on the Social Welfare Department to put more trust in local governments and have better coordination in handing out the educational aid.
DSWD, kulang ng manpower yan. Yung manpower nandyan sa local government unit through DSWS. At saka yung mga mismong human resource from the barangays. Pinaka-importante sana na mag-re-respetuhay, saka mag-i-establish ng trust and confidence na financial assistance. It cannot definitely be as effective, efficient, and orderly if there is no close coordination.
Over 53,000 indigent Filipino students received educational aid from government over the weekend.
Women's group Gabriela condemns what it calls the Philippine National Police's harassment of children's rights advocates in Quezon City yesterday. Gabriela says members of Salinlahi Philippines Alliance for Children's Concerns and their own group were distributing hygiene kits and food packs at President Corazon Aquino Elementary School for kids who were going back to school when they were intimidated and violently terrorized by Batasan police officers. A video posted online showed the police confiscating their materials. But in a statement, the Quezon City Police Department explained that the groups were initially allowed to distribute alcohol and school supplies. They were only reprimanded when they started bringing out placards and streamers for a program. The PNP says this disrupted the entry of students and parents into the school. For her reaction to this, we are joined by Gabriela Secretary General, Clarice Falsen. Good morning, Clarice. Thank you for joining us.
Good morning. Thank you for inviting us.
Okay, so you're denouncing PNP's violent harassment and physical assault of children's rights advocates while the groups distributed hygiene kits and food packs in the school mentioned earlier. But can you tell us what exactly happened there and what's your reaction to PNP's statement?
Actually, we in Gabriela is actually in coordination with children's rights organizations such as Salinlahi and Children's Rehabilitation Center and actually a local chapter of Gabriela Women's Party. We actually planned to conduct a relief distribution among young students of President Corazon Aquino Elementary School in Batasan Road. And then while our volunteer members were distributing hygiene kits and food packs for the young students, police officers suddenly came and started to threaten the activists who were actually trying to negotiate peacefully so that the relief drive would at least continue. And then they were actually mostly saying that we have only few minutes left, no, para mag-distribute ng
so they were putting relief. A time. Yeah.
Actually, they actually said that we only have 5 minutes or less than 5 minutes to distribute because according to them, we are disrupting the environment. But according to our volunteers and our local chapters, and as well as from the Salinlahi and the Children Rehabilitation Center staff, they were actually giving or distributing relief drive peacefully. And yung mga bata, yung mga magulang, actually sila pa yung lumalapit doon sa mga volunteers because we are actually talking to them. No, we are actually kinukuha namin yung ano ba yung gusto nilang mangyari sa unang araw ng pagbabalik eskwela. But then what happens next was several police officers of Batasan Police Station 6 came to our members, came to our volunteers, and then started to violently intimidate, violently harass, disrupt the activity to the point that they physically assaulted, no, yung mga volunteers or mga staff ng Salin Lahi and Children's Rehabilitation Center. So, ang reaction namin doon sa nilabas na press release, no, ng QCPD, that is an outright lie. Hindi totoo na peacefully nila kaming pinaalis doon sa school. Hindi totoo na peacefully silang nakipag-negotiate, kasi for the longest time, palagi nilang ginagawa yan na binibigyan nila kami ng time, parang gusto ba nilang sabihin na wala ng democratic right, wala ng democratic space yung iba't ibang mga individuals and organizations to conduct activity or even a relief drive para sa mga bata.
But Clarice, let's go back to the PNP statement that you were quote, disrupting classes there daw through placards and streamers. Did you really bring such? And what was written on such placards and streamers, if you may ask?
Actually, yung kinagagalitan, no, ng police officers ay yung parang visual na dala-dala. Visual materials na dala-dala ng Salin Lahi organization and children.
There were protest statements daw, no?
Actually, ang nakasulat doon ay yung ligtas na balik eskwela, ipaglaban. So, ang kinagalitan ng police officers ay yung specific word na ipaglaban. Parang gusto nilang sabihin na huwag ipaglaban yung ligtas na balik eskwela, huwag nating ipanawagan pagbabalik eskwela ng ligtas para sa mga bata. Actually, yun yung pinaka-observe namin na dun sila galit na ipaglaban. Kasi paulit-ulit nila yung sinabi doon sa mga volunteers namin to the point na habang nag-negotiate at ay talagang nag-init ata yung ulo ng mga kapulisan natin at talagang diretso na they tried to illegally arrest volunteers of Salin Lahi and Children's Rehabilitation Center. And actually, they caused trauma to the young students and actually to their parents.
Seeing police lining up school.
Yes. Actually, we have videos. We have several photos to back up our claim na hindi natakot yung mga bata at mga magulang dun sa activity na nilunsad namin. Natakot sila dun sa panggugulo ng mga police na armado. Kasi kami, wala kaming ibang dala kundi mga relief materials, wala kaming ibang dala kundi hygiene kits, food packs, and even yung mga visual materials namin to para ipakita yung mga demands namin na 15,000, actually 10,000 na student aid para sa mga bata na kailangan ngayon dahil walang malinaw na guidelines or concrete plans para sa pagbabalik eskwela ng mga bata. Nananawagan din kami ng higher education budget, lalo na ngayong 2023 na talagang pinupush through ng Marcos Jr. and Sara Duterte administration yung reopening of schools.
Let's get to those requests no later on. But ano bang legal actions you plan to hold accountable those police officers? Have you spoken to the QCPD chief or Quezon City Mayor Joy Belmonte about this incident?
Actually, we already talked to the volunteers and staff and members involved in those activity. We reached out to them, we talked to them, kinuha namin yung kanilang mga narrative so that we can start to make a case to be filed in the People's Law Enforcement Board in Quezon City because this happened in Quezon City. And we are still talking to our lawyers para alamin kung ano yung pwede pa namin gawin sa susunod. But as of now, we are in full coordination with Representative Arlene Rosas of Gabriela Women's Party. And we are planning to seek the office of Mayor Joy Belmonte today to conduct a dialogue and talk about what happened with Quezon City Police District and police officers of police Batasan Police Station 6, because actually we have their names, we have their ranks, and we will put that in our sworn statement para mapanagot actually yung mga may gawa nito sa amin.
And Carisma, according to you, various videos captured violence and forced seizures of materials while police officers also tried to actually arrest two illegally, no, two Salinlahi members named Tiben Wahe, and the other one was in Samyana while distributing nga yung kits to the children. How are these two right now, and how is this act of generosity against the law, at least from the point of view of the PNP?
Actually, Tiben and Kim were actually traumatized by what happened yesterday, because they went there in good faith to conduct relief drive for the children, because yun yung ginagawa nila eh bilang mga child rights advocates. Yun talaga yung nakasanayan nila, na mamamahal din sila ng mga school supplies, mamamahal din sila ng hygiene kits sa mga bata. Pero ang natunghaya nila doon yung harassment ng PNP, no, ng QCPD. So those were the things na pinakakinatatakutan ng mga child rights advocates, na pati sila na nakikipaglaban or nagsusulong ng karapatan ng mga bata ay iteterrorize ng PNP sa harapan mismo ng mga bata na gustong-gusto nilang tulungan. And ang gusto namin sa PNP, no law is actually violated doon sa ginawa namin na pamamahaling ng relief drive. And actually, we are not actually planning to conduct a rally or a program there. We just want to conduct a relief drive for those young children in President Rizal Aquino Elementary School.
You just happen to have placards saying, let's fight for, So considering how this is, you know, far from being the first instance of harassment from the PNP towards your groups, how have these incidents in the past been resolved?
Actually, nangyayari siya palagi. Palagi na nagko-conduct kami ng any type of activity in public space. Relief operations man yan sa iba't ibang regions. Ang sumasang mga members namin ay mga military officers. Pag assembly sa mga communities, kung saan nag-organize yung mga members namin, because that is our right, that is our freedom of association, freedom to organize. May mga police officers agad na lumalapit, they were asking for the names of our members, they were asking for the names, for the address of our local leaders. And then, lalo na kapag may protest action, nanlulunsad yung Gabriela. Sobrang violent harassment, violent intimidation. Yeah. Threatening us to illegally arrest because we have no permit, like such as that. So yeah,
and Clarice, how are they resolved, no? Sa kaduluduluhan, do you feel like when you do file complaints na, the law would be on your side, that these police would eventually be held accountable? Has that ever happened? O nawawala na lang yung issue?
Actually, we are trying our best, no, na mag-file ng mga cases against these abusive police officers, and we are hoping na talagang mapalagot sila this time. Pero sa matagal na panahon, laganap yung impunity sa bansa natin. Lalo na yung mga nasa kapangyarihan talaga ay pinapahintulutan na hindi mapalagot yung mga police officers, yung mga military officers sa mga pinagagawa nila against progressive organizations and progressive thinking individuals. Pero at least we do our best, di ba? At least we're trying our best to file different cases so that at least kung mapagbibigyan, di mapapanagot yung mga may kasalanan at nanakit sa amin.
And the authorities following all this, no, those incidents in the past and this very recent one, what does this mean for political dissent? And how do you see this new administration handling this issue?
Actually, parang it's a sign na lumiliit yung democratic space para sa mga mamamayan. Kasi pati yung simpleng pamamahagi ng relief, pamamahagi ng aid, pamamahagi ng kung ano mang pwedeng maitulong sa mga kababayan natin ay binabansagan na krimen, hindi pinapahintulutan, pinapaalis na para bang walang gagawing mabuti. It's a sign or actually, merong chilling effect talaga yung ganitong ginagawa nila sa mga organizations, mga progressive individuals. Kasi kapag nagtagumpay sila na papatahimik yung mga progressive critical organizations, papaano pa yung mga individuals na gusto rin magsalita, gusto rin mag-express ng kanilang opinion, gusto mag-practice ng kanilang freedom of speech, no? At maging critical sa mga policies ng government natin sa kasalukuyan.
And Clarice, lastly, before we let you go, what's your call to the government in light of the reopening of face-to-face classes on health and educational reform?
First of all, since they were announcing that they want a 100% face-to-face classes, we're actually demanding them to have a concrete, no, and systematic plan for the reopening of schools. We are calling the national government to allocate higher education budget for our next school year, and then distribute 10,000 student aid for those students in crisis, especially now that we are still facing the pandemic. And talagang siguraduhin na magiging ligtas yung mga bata at mga estudyante sa darating na pasukan. Especially now na na-witness natin na pumasok yung mga bata habang may baha, pumasok yung mga bata na kulang-kulang yung mga classroom, kulang-kulang yung mga chairs, kulang-kulang yung mga materials na gagamitin na mahalaga para sa pagbabalik sa eskwela. So those were our calls. And hopefully, matugunan siya, no, ng national government.
All right. On that note, thanks for being on the program this morning, Clarice. You stay safe.
Thank you.
Now, on to more news. The Philippines detects its fourth case of the monkeypox virus. The health department says it's a 25-year-old Filipino with no travel history to countries with cases of the disease. The patient is currently in an isolation facility. 14 of the patient's close contacts have also been identified. One of them is in the same isolation facility as the patient. The health department says all four confirmed monkeypox cases in the Philippines are unrelated to each other. For infectious diseases expert Dr. Ronjin Solande, this may mean that local transmission of the virus has already taken place.
We are still establishing actually the source of infection. Although dito sa 14 na close contacts niya, nobody's exhibiting signs and symptoms.
There could be a possibility of local transmission. It's important now that at this point, based on these findings, itong kaso na wala siyang history of travel, they really have to extract the history dito sa positive na to.
New COVID-19 cases in the Philippines stay below the 3,000 mark. Health officials logged 3,077 more infections on Monday, pushing the number of active cases to over 33,000. 29 deaths were also reported from August 15 to 21. The country recorded an average of 3,412 daily infections, which is over 15% lower compared to the previous week. But a health expert expects cases to rise again as schools reopen. Dr. Edsel Salvanya believes this is why extending the state of public health emergency in the country is crucial.
Yung data natin is always yung parang wait and see tayo. It usually takes 2 to 4 weeks for any kind of intervention that we do to be able to say na okay itong ginawa natin or kontrolado siya or tumataas. So lalong na ngayon, nagbubukas tayo ng classes. We're going to see the effect of this on transmission about 2 to 4 weeks from now. So it's probably a good idea na the state of emergency is continuous para kung sakali man biglang tumaas ay nandiyan pa rin, in place pa rin po yung ating mga safeguards para mas maganda po yung control natin.
And we are taking a quick break. Up ahead, education and infrastructure development are top priorities in the proposed 2023 national budget.
At the face of America's pandemic response, Dr. Anthony Fauci is set to resign from his government post. These and more when the rundown returns. Stay tuned.
Welcome back to The Rundown. The headlines across the web. Philippine Star's top story, local pump prices go up today. After 7 straight weeks of rollbacks, Manila Bulletin's headline, the Philippine military says it's still validating the reported deaths of alleged communist leaders Benito and Wilma Tiamzon. And topping JMA News' website, a surprise inspection by customs officials reveals tons of suspected smuggled rice and sugar in a warehouse in Caloocan.
Philippine President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. seeks a 5.29 trillion peso national budget from lawmakers to fund government projects in his first year in office. RG Cruz tells us which sectors are getting the biggest outlay for 2023.
The Department of Budget and Management has submitted to the House of Representatives the 2023 National Expenditure Program worth 5.268 trillion pesos, 4.9% higher than the 2022 budget. Education takes the biggest chunk of next year's spending plan, among others that funds free college tuition, facilities and learning materials, assistance and scholarships. Infrastructure spending is second, with money allocated to the construction of more roads and railways. Health gets the third biggest allocation, with provisions to buy more COVID-19 vaccines.
It is in under the unprogrammed fund because we still have vaccines in our inventory. But once na sinabing meron ng kailangan ulit kung bumili ng mga yung ano sa reformatted vaccines, we have sufficient cover under the unprogrammed appropriation. If I'm not mistaken, mga 20 plus billion yun eh.
Different agencies will also be giving away various assistance. But the DBM admits the spending plan doesn't cover yet the additional pension for indigent senior citizens.
The law lapsed into law after the budget has already been completed. So we did not provide. That's around 24.5 billion pesos. So we would like to defer to the wisdom of Congress on this, although we will be providing them with the utilization rates of various departments so that they will at least know where it can be sourced.
Rounding up the top five, agriculture spending, with the National Rice Program getting 30 billion pesos. The National Task Force to End Local Communist Armed Conflict, or NTFL-CAC, remains alive, though spending under its Barangay Development Program will be subject to guidelines. There's also money for the poorest local government units.
Ito po yung LCAC. Ang budget po natin siya ng this year is 5.62, and then we increase it to 10 billion for 2023. And kasama din po dito yung budget po natin for Growth Equity Fund. Ito po yung pondo for our 4th, 5th, and 6th municipalities and barangays po para mabigyan po natin sila ng mga enough programs and projects po para at least po makaabot po sila dun sa mga mas mataas na mga municipalities po. And we also have the financial assistance to LGUs po of 5 billion pesos.
The House vowed to give final approval before October 1, when Congress is scheduled to go on its first recess that will last up to November.
And we have committed to the executive its swift passage for its signing to law before the end of the year.
The House already began pre-budget briefings in a bid to resolve lawmakers' individual concerns and minimize debates. The DBM hopes to have the President sign the budget into law by Christmas. RG Cruz, ABS-CBN News.
A Filipino-British nurse who became known for administering the first COVID-19 vaccine in the world is calling on the Philippine government and the Filipino people to fight misinformation about vaccines as part of the bid to encourage more to get vaccinated. May Parsons, who also received the prestigious George Cross Medal on behalf of the United Kingdom's National Health Service last month, is also advocating for better treatment for nurses here in the Philippines and in the UK, where she herself braved through racism, inequality, and the challenges of the COVID pandemic to become one of the most recognizable Filipino nurses in the world. May joins us now via Zoom. May, good morning. Good to see you again. And thanks for taking our call, even as you are supposed to travel this morning.
Good morning, Mike. It's so lovely to be here with you all, and thank you for having me.
All right. So, May, first, take us back to that moment when all eyes around the world were on you as you were about to administer the first COVID vaccine outside clinical trials to a 90-year-old British grandmother. What was going on in your mind at that time, and how significant was that event for you?
It was a time of hope. I think it just signified that actually we are nearly there. It's the start of us being able to fight back in the pandemic. At that time, it has been a few months, nearly 6 or 7 months since the pandemic has started or has been announced. And the nurses like me and all other health workers weren't able to kind of equip themselves with anything to protect themselves or their patients against COVID-19. And giving out the vaccination actually entailed that it is nearly there. We are going to be fighting back, and it's nearly the end of the pandemic because we are going to be able to give these vaccines to protect our communities. I felt hopeful. I felt positive. I felt extremely grateful for all those people who has actually worked really hard, you know, to provide this treatment or to provide this vaccine. And I think the devastation that we've seen all throughout those months of worry and fear, it was just wonderful to feel that it's finally going to be over. So I think that the only issue we have now is for people to actually take on the vaccine, which obviously have been proven to be safe and effective against the COVID-19. And if I need to go out there in the community to tell them, I think it's really vitally important that we get the right messages out there. Mm-hmm. You know, people are still listening to fake news, misinformations in social media, which sometimes is the only place that they could get their information from. And they're not always reliable to be the truth and to be scientifically based information.
We'll get to vaccinations in a bit, May, but a more recent event last month, this time you were chosen to receive, on behalf of the National Health Service, the George Cross Medal from Queen Elizabeth II herself. So how was the experience?
Surreal. It was intensely surreal. It was like a dream. It was not like something that I would be thinking about. You know, growing up in Pasay in Manila, for a small girl traveling across half the world, it was not something that I even thought about. I didn't think it was possible at all in this lifetime or the next 100 lifetimes. So to be honoured and privileged to be doing that on behalf of all the NHS workers who responded to the pandemic in the UK, it's absolutely amazing.
Mm-hmm. Did you at any point, you said this is unimaginable, but at any point in your 20-year journey as a Filipino nurse in the UK, did you ever imagine that this two key moments would actually come? Because nobody else can claim to have given the first jab in the world, and not everyone gets to meet the queen, much less get recognized for their work.
Absolutely, no. I don't think in my lifetime I've read about and learned about pandemics in the past. I don't think I ever thought that we were going to be experiencing the pandemic, you know, and it's not something that anyone would wish to have and to experience. The enormity of the responsibility of it was just huge and quite heavy, just to make sure that I just wanted to represent everyone. But no, not at all. It was not something that even talking to you now, it's not something, being a nurse, going into nursing, it's a caring profession. It's something that you do by the bedside. It's something that you do caring for other people. And it's selfless vocation. Never in my wildest dreams that going into nursing would bring me into such a limelight, give me such a platform and a voice and a face and to be known by millions of people. So no, not at all. It's not something that I was expecting when I went to nursing.
Mm-hmm. And let's talk about your journey in nursing in the UK. What was it that drove you to go to the United Kingdom and look for opportunities there? You graduated from the University of Santo Tomas in 2000. You worked for the USD Hospital for 3 years. But what were the conditions then that led you to the UK?
Well, USD, my alma mater where I graduated nursing from, it's a really good establishment, whether it's their schools, their values that they have obviously professed to our staff and to our students. They're really great. So I've decided I'm not going to apply anywhere else but USD. If I'm going to be working in a hospital, that is where I wanted to be. Mm-hmm. But obviously, we have got pressures, we have got aspirations for our futures and our families. And for me to be able to go to the UK and practice my nursing there meant that I'd be able to provide better for my future. And that's basically it. It's nothing to do at that time. Pay in USD hospital is actually quite good. Comparatively, you know, with other hospitals, they are quite really good employers. However, it doesn't compare to working in the US or Canada or UK. That's the only really push is for my future and for my family. I couldn't say anything bad about USD. They have been really great in terms of schools and also being an employer.
Mm-hmm. Right. But how was that journey being a Filipino-British nurse in the UK? You did say you've had your fair share of discrimination and unequal treatment.
Yeah, absolutely. There is a lot of that going on at the not so obvious. It's not something that is blatantly out there. We experience those microaggressions daily. And it's something that as Filipinos, you know, we strive to just overcome and we strive to, for me, for my peace of mind and my own well-being. Those are the things that I try not to get to me. And also, like I said, to the student nurses and to the nurses that I've spoken to on this journey, I said to them that it is your responsibility to put a stop to anything that you feel isn't right. I've always said that the standards you let pass is the standards you accept. And, you know, it might not be happening to you, it could be happening to someone else, but it's something that has to be actively challenged. Otherwise, it will just keep carrying on. I think we are still trying to create that voice and that platform for our internationally educated nurses to have a voice, to have that seat at the table where decisions are being made about us, for us. So I think at the moment we are still actively trying to get to that mountain and actively challenging the system to recognize that we are not just, you know, numbers. We are not just skilled workers from everywhere around the globe to come to the UK or in any other countries. We are deserving of, you know, equality and equity of rights as like anybody else. As like, you know, we have got our opinions, we've got our intentions, we've got our aspirations and our values. And I think those are recognized, it should be recognized that are deserving of a place in the decision making.
Mm-hmm. And May, coming back to the Philippines 2 decades later, are you seeing the conditions of your fellow nurses improving, not just in private hospitals, but even in public hospitals?
Well, locally, if we're talking about the Philippines, I've heard a lot of horrific instances where nurses are not being paid enough to actually survive. These are relayed to me by nurses who are working here in the Philippines. And I just feel really sorry for them that these are the things or the conditions that they're working on. I think, you know, for the skills and the care that we provide the people of the communities, I think they deserve more, definitely deserve more. I heard that some Filipinos were being paid 5,000 pesos a month, and nursing curriculum is not that cheap. And for the intensity of our training, the intensity of our work and the work we do, I think we deserve more. They deserve more. These nurses have got their own families, they've got their own problems, they've got their own strife. And for the skills that they provide, you know, the expertise that they have, they do deserve more. they are the ones that are at the bedside. They are the ones who's going to be holding your relatives or your hands in times of need. These are the people who's going to be looking after you 24 hours a day. There is no other profession that will be doing the same thing that nurses do. And I think the government, whoever is deciding these, need to be looking out for their people that actually provides the care that nobody else can. Nurses are integral to the success of our communities, and they deserve better. They deserve more, absolutely deserve more.
All right, on that note, unfortunately, maybe we don't have much time, but thank you so much for joining us this morning and for sharing your insights with us.
Thank you so much for having me, Mike.
Moving on to more news, Philippine lawmakers grilled resigned officials from the Agriculture Department and the Sugar Regulatory Board over the sugar importation controversy. Former SRA Administrator Hermenegildo Serafica asserts low supply prompted them to craft Sugar Order No. 4. But upon questioning, he admitted some protocols were not followed.
Did you follow the protocols? Even without MC No. 1, sinunod mo ba yung protocol? Yes or no?
No, Your Honor.
Bakit hindi nyo ginawa yung protocol in accordance with your manual?
I was a victim of MC 1, Memorandum Circular No. 1. When it came out, the three deputies and the legal department manager talked among themselves that, you know, our term ended on June 30, 2022.
Former Agriculture Undersecretary Leocadio Sebastian Minua insists signing the order was in line with his duties, but he said he may have misunderstood President Ferdinand Marcos Jr.
I signed for the Secretary of Agriculture.
Yeah, but he's also the President of the Republic of the Philippines.
Based on the authority given to me in a July 15 memorandum by the executive secretary. The memorandum, Mr. Chair, states that I will sit as ex officio chairman or member of all duly constituted committees, councils, boards, or bodies where the Secretary of Agriculture is a member. And I therefore participated in good faith. When he disapproved it, I immediately gave my resignation out of delicadeza.
In news overseas, the face of America's COVID-19 response will be resigning at the end of the year. In a statement, Dr. Anthony Fauci announced he will be stepping down from his government positions in December. That includes his position as U.S. President Joe Biden's chief medical advisor, as well as the director of the National Institute of Allergy and Infectious Diseases, where he has served for 38 years. But he clarified he is not retiring. The 81-year-old instead said he will pursue the next chapter of his career. President Biden, meanwhile, said America is stronger and more resilient because of Fauci. Fauci became a trusted and reassuring voice for Americans when the pandemic broke out in 2020. But his honest takes on government's early failures in its COVID-19 response earned him death threats, with him and his family now living with security protection.
Over in Ukraine, President Volodymyr Zelensky's advisor denies Kyiv is behind the bombing that killed the daughter of a hardline Russian ideologue. Daria Dugina, the daughter of Alexander Dugin, a vocal supporter of the Kremlin's offensive in Ukraine, was killed last Saturday when a bomb placed in the vehicle she was driving went off. The Kremlin believes the father was likely the target of the attack. The incident has raised fears of an escalation of Russia's war in Ukraine, which will be marking its 6th month on August 24.
Indiana's governor leads the third U.S. delegation to visit Taiwan this month. Eric Holcomb met with Taiwanese President Tsai Ing-wen as part of a, quote, economic development trip. Holcomb told the Taiwanese leader the U.S. and Taiwan share many common values, interests, and goals.
There are more opportunities ahead of us than I think there ever have been before for us to continue to strengthen and cultivate and nurture this relationship. As our economies grow and grow together, we will continue to seek to build strategic partnerships with you.
Meanwhile, Tsai called on allies to continue supporting Taiwan amid military threats from China. Earlier this month, U.S. House Speaker Nancy Pelosi visited Taiwan, drawing anger from Beijing. A week later, five other U.S. lawmakers made a trip to the South Rule Island, which China claims as its own territory.
And that's the rundown today. I'm Mike Navalio. You can watch highlights, recaps, exclusive content of our shows online.
And I'm Nikki De Guzman. Subscribe to the ANC YouTube channel, like us on Facebook, and follow us on Twitter. Head Start comes your way next. Stay with ANC.